Welcome back, children. Now, coming to today's class in magnetism and matter, okay, we'll be studying about a device which is called as vibrational magnetometer. So, before studying this device, okay, if you remember, in the last class, we have discussed about what are the three elements of Earth's magnetism. Okay, what are the three elements? One is declination. Second is dip or inclination. And the last one is called Earth's horizontal component, represented by the letter BH. See, to determine the declination of a given place, okay, we need to identify the magnetic meridian. And I told you, by making use of a compass needle, we can identify the magnetic meridian. Whereas coming to dip or inclination, this can be calculated by using a device called as dip circle, which is a vertically pivoted magnetic needle. Now, to find out the Earth's magnetic field, that means horizontal component, or to compare the value of BH at two different places, we can make use of a device which is called as vibrational magnetometer. Okay, so therefore, to understand this vibrational magnetometer, first, we will go back to the study of a bar magnet. Okay, so for a bar magnet, let us see how do we define magnetic moment. So to understand this, see, if you consider an electric dipole, okay, we know magnet is a magnetic dipole, whereas for an electric dipole, if you have negative and positive charges separated by a finite distance, how did we define the dipole moment? It is the product of charge into distance between the charges. So exactly similar to this, for a bar magnet, okay, say you have a bar magnet, it has two poles, north and south, separated by a finite distance. So if the pole strength of this magnet is represented by the letter M and the distance between the poles as L, then magnetic dipole moment, it is defined as the product of pole strength into length of the magnet. So here M is called the pole strength. Larger the magnitude of the pole strength, stronger will be the magnetic moment. And it has a unit ampere meter. Remember, current element, when we studied Biot-Savart's law, current element also has the same unit, ampere into meter. So it is equivalent to the pole strength in case of a bar magnet. So pole strength into length will give you magnetic moment. And the direction of this magnetic moment is always directed from south to north. Okay, we have assigned the direction because it's a vector quantity. It is directed from south to north. If you remember, for a dipole, what was the direction? Negative to positive. So here it is from south pole to north pole. But here, when you are studying about the length of a magnet, remember this point. See, the actual north and south poles are slightly inside the magnet. Okay, this length is called the geometric length. External length, what we see, is called the geometric length. The actual north and south pole are present inside the magnet. So if this is your south and north pole, the distance between the north and the south poles, this length is called magnetic length. The geometric length is slightly greater than the magnetic length. So if you identify the relationship between them, you have an experiment to find out or locate the north and south poles. So if you can locate this north and south poles, we can prove that the magnetic length of a magnet is slightly lesser than the geometric length, which is nearly 0.84 times the geometric length. Okay, remember this relation. Magnetic length is 0.84 times the geometric length. So here, when you are defining the magnetic moment, actually it should be the magnetic length. But we generally ignore the small change and take it as length of the magnet. M is equal to small m into L, where small m is called the pole strength. So I repeat, how do we define magnetic moment of a bar magnet? It is a product of pole strength into length. Pole strength has a unit ampere meter. So magnetic moment will have a unit What is the unit for magnetic dipole moment? Ampere into meter square. It is directed from south to north. Okay, now coming to what would happen when you cut a magnet along its length or perpendicular to its length. Okay, say for example, you are given a bar magnet whose magnetic moment is capital M. Okay, now I will divide this into two equal parts by cutting it along its axis. See, when you cut it along the axis, we get two magnets. Okay, if the length of the previous one is L, even this will have the same length. Okay, length is same, but we have got two separate magnets. So if the pole strength of the previous magnet is small m, since you have cut it along the axis, the pole strength of these two magnets will reduce to half. So what will happen to the pole strength when you cut the magnet along its axis? Pole strength is reduced to half because we have divided it into two equal parts. Now the new magnetic moment, can I write it as the new pole strength, m by 2 into length is L. So tell me, what will be the new magnetic moment if the previous value was capital L? Okay, previously it was m into L. Now it is m by 2 into L. So the magnetic moment reduces to half. Okay, each magnet will have a magnetic moment m by 2 when you cut it along its axis. Let's see what would happen if you cut it perpendicular to its length. Say I took a magnet whose magnetic moment is m into L, capital M. If I divide it along this line, okay, now I am going to get two bar magnets whose length is L by 2. Each one has a length L by 2. But pole strength will remain as it is. Pole strength decreases only when you cut it along its axis. Now what is a new magnetic moment? Pole strength is M. Length is L by 2. This time length has reduced it to half. So the new magnetic moment becomes M divided by 2. So sometimes they may give you a magnet is bent in the form of an arc of a circle, then what will be its magnetic moment? Okay, say you are given a bar magnet whose magnetic moment is capital M. Now I am going to bend it to form an arc, okay, which subtends an angle theta. Now this is your south pole and the north pole. Now I need the distance between the north and south pole to get the magnetic moment. See, pole strength is not going to change because we are not cutting the magnet, we are just bending it. Pole strength is not changing, but length is going to change. Now let's calculate the length AB. So select a point C, drop a line here so that this angle is divided as theta by 2 and theta by 2. I'll call this point as O. Okay, the radius of this arc is capital R. Tell me, what will be the distance from A to C from this triangle? We can write AC as R sine theta by 2. Okay, from triangle OAC, sine theta by 2 is AC by radius. I have written AC as R sine theta by 2. So, can I write the length AB as 2 times of AC? Okay, this whole length is AC plus CB, both are equal. So I can write AB as 2 times of AC. So what is the length of the new magnet? It is 2R sine theta by 2. Call this as equation 1. And once you get the length, what will be its new magnetic moment? Pole strength into length of the magnet. That means distance from south pole to north pole, which is AB. So I will write M dash is equal to pole strength is M, AB is 2R sine theta by 2. Now since radius is not given to you in the question, okay, we can write this radius. R is equal to, okay, we know length of the arc. L is equal to R into theta. Implies what is R equal to? L divided by theta. So if you replace this radius as L by theta into sine theta by 2. What will be your new magnetic moment? M into L was the previous magnetic moment, capital M. This 2 will remain as it is, by theta into sine theta divided by 2. Okay, so if I write this as 2m by theta into sine theta by 2, will this give me the new magnetic moment of the magnet after you bend it in the form of an arc? So remember this relation. If a magnet is bent in the form of an arc which subtends an angle theta, then the new magnetic moment is 2m by theta into sine theta by 2. Okay, we get some applications related to this equation. Okay, look at this example. If a bar magnet of magnetic moment capital M is bent in the form of a semicircle, okay, determine the new magnetic moment. Okay, we know what should be the angle of a semicircle. Theta is equal to 180 degrees. I'll write it as pi. Then what will be the new magnetic moment? Now I can apply my formula. Okay, we know it is 2m by theta into sine theta by 2. Theta should be in radians. What is m dash equal to? 2m by pi sine 180 by 2. It is sine 90. And we know the value of sine 90 is 1. So what should be the magnetic moment of a magnet which is bent in the form of a semicircle? New magnetic moment is 2m divided by pi. Okay, this is how you can identify. Any angle can be given. I took an example of a semicircle. Or sometimes the question can be like this. See, there is a bar magnet whose magnetic moment is m. It is cut along the axis into two parts and the two portions are placed as shown in the figure. Determine the resultant magnetic moment. We know magnetic moment is a vector quantity. See, first when you cut the magnet along its axis, magnetic moment will become m by 2. So for this magnet, magnetic dipole moment is m by 2 along x axis. For this magnet, south to north, the magnetic moment is m by 2 along y axis. What is the angle between them? 90 degrees. Now we can apply parallelogram law of vector addition. What will be the resultant magnetic moment of the arrangement? Under root m by 2 whole square plus m by 2 whole square. Okay, you will get the answer root 2 times of m by 2. Okay, nothing but m divided by root. So this type of questions can also be given. Or the question can be like this. Three magnets are arranged in the form of an equilateral triangle. But when you are solving the question, look at the polarities clearly. So this is south and north, south and north, south and north. Angle is 60 degrees. Okay, it is an equilateral triangle. So in such a case, what is the resultant magnetic moment? See, from south to north, is this the magnetic moment M? South to north, M. Again south to north. All the three vectors are forming a closed figure. From triangle law of vector addition, what is the resultant magnetic moment? It becomes zero. So because they are arranged with unlike poles together, we got the answer as zero. If they are not arranged with unlike poles together, use parallelogram law of vector addition. Or they may give you three magnets of same magnetic moment. Okay, three identical bar magnets are given with the magnetic moment capital M. So these three are arranged to form a U shape like this. One of them is bent in the form of a semicircle. This is how they are arranged. Again, unlike poles are together. What is the resultant magnetic moment of this arrangement? Use vector addition. South to north. Okay, one magnetic moment is upward. South to north. This is horizontal. But remember, what will be its magnetic moment when you bend it in the form of a semicircle? Just now I told you. Will it become 2m by pi? So I'll make it 2m by pi. For this magnet, south to north, capital M acting downward. So one moment is upward, one moment is downward. These two will cancel each other. What are we left with? It is equal to 2m by pi in I cap direction. So various arrangements will be given. We can go for just simple vector addition to get the resultant magnetic moment. Okay, so this is one of the very often asked questions, giving different arrangements, like two magnets may be placed like this. Okay, it has a dipole moment M1. Another magnet is placed below it with magnetic moment M2. What is the net magnetic moment of the arrangement? Since both of them are in same direction, we will write M1 plus M2 in I cap direction. If you reverse one of them, then your net magnetic moment will become M1 minus M2. If M2 is reversed, I'll write M1 minus M2 in I cap direction. So like this, many arrangements of the magnets can be given to find out the resultant magnetic moment. To torque acting on a bar magnet. Okay, so what will happen when you place a bar magnet in an external magnetic field? So remember, when we studied for a dipole, we have proved that when a dipole is placed in a uniform electric field, it experiences a torque. Okay, if this was your uniform electric field, okay, each charge will experience a force EQ, and because of this external electric field, it is going to rotate. And what is the torque? We have derived it as P cross E, where P is the dipole moment and E is your electric field. So exactly similar to that, when you place a bar magnet in a uniform magnetic field, so assume there is a magnetic field directed from left to right, and in this you have kept a bar magnet whose dipole moment is capital M. So the north pole, okay, magnetic field is directed from north to south. South pole is attracted by north and north pole is attracted by south. As a result, the magnet will rotate about its center and aligns in the direction of magnetic field. And we can prove the same thing, so I'm not deriving it. Exactly similar to this, what will be the formula for torque acting on a bar magnet? It will be equal to M cross B. Okay, just now I told you what is the magnetic dipole moment. If magnetic dipole moment is M and the field is capital B, torque is equal to M cross B. And when will you say this magnet is in stable equilibrium? If theta is equal to 0 degrees. Say if your magnet aligns such that dipole moment and magnetic field are in same direction, the net force acting on this dipole is 0, net torque is also 0, theta is equal to 0 degrees, and potential energy is minimum. Okay, how did we write potential energy for a dipole? Minus of P dot E. Similarly, here we can write the potential energy of a magnetic dipole as minus M dot B, M into B into cos theta. Cross product is M into B into sine theta. So when potential energy is minimum, what is the minimum potential energy? Put theta equal to 0, it's minus M into B. So these are the conditions to say that this dipole is in which equilibrium? Stable equilibrium. When do you say a dipole is in unstable equilibrium? If you reverse the position. Okay, this is your external magnetic field. The dipole is arranged in opposite direction such that dipole moment is opposite to the applied electric field. What is the net torque acting on the system? Still 0. Net force is also 0. Theta is 180 degrees. But potential energy is maximum. What is the maximum value? M into B. Then such an equilibrium we call it as unstable equilibrium. So everything that we studied for an electric dipole is also applicable for a magnetic dipole. but only change is instead of E we will use B. Dipole moment, electric dipole moment is replaced with magnetic dipole moment. So these are the conditions for stable and unstable equilibrium and unstable equilibrium. Okay, now let us see what would happen when a magnet is displaced from its stable equilibrium position. So there is an external uniform magnetic field and your magnet is in stable equilibrium. Magnetic field is directed along x-axis. Your dipole moment is also same. Now this is in stable equilibrium. Now we will displace the magnet through a small angle, theta. See, I have rotated this magnet through a small angle theta. Then will there be a restoring torque to bring it back to equilibrium position? So what is that restoring torque equal to? The restoring torque is minus of m cross b, that is m into b into sine theta. Again, I'm repeating, we have displaced the magnet through a small angle theta. Torque will try to bring it back to initial position. So the restoring torque, I'm writing with a minus sign because it's bringing it back to equilibrium as m into b into sine theta. If theta is very small, we know sine theta tends to theta. Then what will be the torque equal to? Minus mb into theta. And we know from rotational dynamics, because you are rotating the magnet about its center, torque can be written as I times of alpha. So I alpha is equal to minus mb into theta. Or what is angular acceleration equal to? Minus of m into b by I into theta. See, is it representing angular simple harmonic motion? If angular acceleration is proportional to negative of angular displacement, we say it is performing angular oscillations. I mean angular simple harmonic motion. And what is this mb by I playing the role of? Omega square. We know alpha is equal to minus omega square theta. So by comparing, we get omega square as mb by I, or omega is equal to square root of m into b divided by I. And if you write omega as 2 pi by t, what is the time period of oscillations of this? It's 2 pi under root I by m into b. B is the magnetic field in which it is oscillating. I is the moment of inertia. Hope you remember what is moment of inertia of a metal rod passing through its center? M into L square by 12. Remember, this M is mass and this capital M is magnetic dipole a moment. And the field is uniform and which is represented as B. So we are going to make use of this relation for understanding the working of a vibrational magnetometer. So that is the reason why I have derived it and showed you that time period of oscillations is 2 pi under root I divided by m into a B H. Now let's look into what is this vibrational magnetometer. Now coming to vibrational magnetometer, look at the construction. So it consists of a glass box. The bottom part of the box is turned into a mirror. That means it is polished on the bottom surface, so that this part is a mirror. And in this, you can suspend one bar magnet connected with a screw. Okay, this is your bar magnet, south to north, which is suspended by means of a string. Okay, so this is your arrangement. Okay, you can suspend a bar magnet by means of a thread, and this is your bar magnet. So to use this vibrational magnetometer, just now I told you, what is the use of this vibrational magnetometer? One is to compare the Earth's horizontal component at two different places. Or you can also make use of this device to compare magnetic moments of two bar magnets, either for comparing the magnetic moments or for comparing the horizontal component of Earth's magnetic field at various places. So to use this device, the first step is keep this vibrational magnetometer such that this magnet and the box are in the magnetic meridian. Okay, how do we place it in the magnetic meridian? Leave the box, magnet automatically comes to rest along north-south, I mean in the direction of BH. So rotate the box such that the plane of the box and the magnet are in the same direction as shown in the figure, not in any other direction. So if you look from the top, the image and the needle, that is the magnetic needle and the image, should coincide. Then you can start your experiment. The experimental procedure is also very simple. Give a small angular displacement to the screw, the magnet will twist and it starts oscillating. Count the number of oscillations in a given interval of time and calculate its time period. Say if you can count the time taken for n number of oscillations, you can find out what is the time taken for one oscillation and find out the time period of oscillations as capital T. Say you know the magnetic moment of the magnet what you have used. Capital M is given to you. We know the magnetic moment. Okay, just now I told you. It is oscillating in Earth's magnetic field. We didn't apply any external magnetic field. So this magnet is placed in the magnetic meridian. So it is oscillating in the magnetic field of Earth, that is BH, horizontal component. So what is your time period of oscillations? T is equal to 2 pi under root I divided by M into BH. Okay, where BH is the Earth's horizontal component. So if you know the time period, if you know the moment of inertia and the magnetic moment, can we determine the value of BH? This is how you can use this device and find out the horizontal component of Earth's magnetic field. And if you have to compare the values of BH at two different places, use the same magnet, keep it in the first place where you are finding the BH, calculate the time period as T1. So in first position or in the first place, you will get this equation, M into BH1. Repeat the experiment by keeping this device in some other place where you want to determine Earth's horizontal component. Let the time period of oscillations be T2. So what is T2 equal to? 2 pi under root, same magnet we are using, so the same moment of inertia, by capital M into BH2. Divide the two relations, T1 by T2 will be square root of BH2 by BH1. See, can we compare the values? So T1 square by T2 square will give you the ratio of horizontal component of Earth's magnetic field at two different places. Okay, this is one method or one application. Suppose you are comparing the magnetic moments. So in such a case, do not change the position of the magnetometer. Keep the first magnet. Find out the time period of oscillations. Say I have got the time period of oscillations as T1. T1 is 2 pi under root I by M into M1 into BH. Similarly, repeat the experiment with the second magnet. You get time period of oscillations T2. T2 is 2 pi under root I by M2 into BH. No change in magnetic field. Again, when you divide these two relations, what will T1 by T2 square come out to be? M2 divided by M1. So either you can compare the magnetic moments or you can compare the Earth's horizontal component. Or sometimes they may give you two magnets with magnetic moments in same direction, time period is T1. When the reverse, one of them is reverse and the time period is T2. Find out the ratio of M1 by M2. So a number of questions can be expected from this particular equation. So remember, time period of oscillations is 2 pi under root I divided by M into BH. So this is your vibrational magnetometer, okay, which helps you in finding out the Earth's horizontal component.